Well, we'll go ahead and get started. Awesome. This is awesome. So again, if you have any questions, I mean, it's free reign tonight. So yeah, so even if it's not, doesn't, you know, pertain to the run, just, yeah, shout it out. Again, like this one's always, you know, we were talking about earlier, like, you know, the run one is always the least attended, because I think sometimes of the triathlon, like it's kind of like, I always think it's either one of two things, like, yeah, I can run, or like, it doesn't really matter what I do, it's, you know, still gonna be horrible. So it tends to be like one of those two feelings around it. But
also that, like, you're done with transitioning and
totally.
So it's like, okay, I just have to go where all the rooms are.
Just follow everybody else. Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. So logistically it's also, yeah. Exactly. There's not a lot, even like with the bikes, there was a lot of gear that we talked about, and swim, wetsuits, stuff like that. I mean, running, like, there's really not much. Sometimes we're like, well, there's nothing over here, we should just pull stuff, but really, as far as like what you really need, not much at all. But what we will go over is what specifically does the Chicago Triathlon's run course look like? What are some of the things to think about on it? How to train for it? Some stuff like that. So, yeah.
Have we started the running bra discussion yet?
We have not.
Okay,
Thank you for reminding me. Yes, okay. We will start that. That will go out the email tomorrow.
That was everybody raved about it.
Yeah.
And it takes me about half an hour to get in there.
Totally. And that's what. Yeah, I wanted to start, and I'll do this for the email that will probably go out on Friday. But I also wanted to, like, to start a discussion, and if people have recommendations of something they found that works for them, that they can share, so then I can pass along to everybody else. Because there's so many different brands out there, you know, and so, yeah. So thank you for that reminder. I knew I was forgetting something after the last clinic. But, okay, so. Yeah, so we talked about it. So the run comes after the swim and the bike. The distances, so for your sprint, you have a 5K. For your international, you have a 10K, so 3.1 or 6.2 miles. Again, Chicago has made these great videos that are just, so this will just be a quick overview of the run.
Transamerica Chicago Triathlon, the run course. The run course in Chicago is truly one of a kind, spanning vast stretches of Chicago's magnificent lakefront through its world-famous parks with breathtaking views around every corner. Beautiful and exciting from the very start.
The run's awesome. You head out of transition, you're running south, hundreds of spectators. It's right near the swim course. You've got all the spectators from the swim course, you're spectating the run as well.
It feels great. So beautiful, and it's not one of those like concrete, very boring path runs. It's so gorgeous. You literally forget that you're in a race.
The 5K sprint distance competitors will cross Walden Drive, then turn around and head back north. Olympic distance racers cover 10K, heading further south past McCormick Place before making their turnaround. Spectacular views throughout the race, passing iconic Chicago landmarks one after another.
You come down to the museum campus area, going through Grant Park, half Buckingham Fountain, all these landmarks, you go around the Shedd Aquarium, Soldier Field, you know, if you really look at distance, past McCormick Place, all these, you know, staples to Chicago. But the best part is actually when you're finished, when you're coming back, you come around the Shedd Aquarium and the skyline just opens up. And that just, there's something about that, just, you know, gives you little chills, and you look up and you're like, wow, this is truly, truly unique race.
At that point, everyone's headed westward, then under Lakeshore Drive, before making one final turn at Columbus Drive for one of the most exciting finishes in all of amateur sport.
You know, that's when the adrenaline kicks in, and you thought you didn't have anything, you all of a sudden found something that you didn't think you had to get to.
When I spin around my corner and I have a final stretch, I'm like a full sprint. It's amazing.
When you get up to the finish line, you come down that street, he's yelling your name. Great race, great job, great finish. And everybody screams for you.
Nice job!
The The race is over, but the party has just begun. Live music, cold drinks, so much food, and an incredible feeling of accomplishment and camaraderie shared by all.
Oh, it's awesome. It's great energy. Everyone's got all their endorphins released. It's awesome to be around all these motivated people.
The run course goes south. So the bike, though they are making some kind of announcement soon about the bike course, I believe. But the run goes south. So you come out of transition and you run along Lakeshore Drive on the path. You go south and then there's a turnaround. You come back and then finish into Grant Park. So it's a pretty straightforward run. A couple of the things just to note about the run, and as you can see from that was clearly a very sunny year at the triathlon, is that there's not a lot of shade. It's pretty much wide open. In the past, you know, if it is a hotter day, they'd have the fire department out like spraying water and stuff. So that's good. There's multiple aid stations along the way. So, and as we talked about gear, that's just something to take into consideration as to whether you want to bring your own water or just take advantage of the aid stations.
It's pretty easy as far as the course. Any questions on the course?
Yeah.
So the turnaround it's right, this yellow dot right here, so it's just south of Soldier Field. So where there's the harbor there and stuff, so that's, yeah, right there. And then the International just goes south of McCormick Place. So.
Oh, that's, you can actually train right there.
Totally. You can run. Yeah. If you wanted to see what it feels like, start up by the yacht club or Monroe Harbor. So that's where transitions. You're going to come. The bike, you come on the north side, you go to transition, you come out on the south side, and then you can just train down to Waldron, whatever it's called, and then up into Grant Park. So, yeah. But as it said, like, it's a pretty cool, they do a very good job. Like, they have the whole way into Grant Park lines, and so it's just, it, there is a lot of adrenaline, so, yeah.
No worries. It's a closed course.
So, it's not, like, most, very few people are going to decide to go out on the path that day for a run. It's not technically a closed course. There can be, I think we have one picture of like one of our athletes coming out of the water, and then there's a runner with like headphones just out for their like Sunday morning run. So it's not completely closed, but like bikers and stuff, you're not going to run into that. You may run into the stray runner who didn't know that Chicago Triathlon was happening and they cut through the course, but frankly, you can't tell who's in. I mean, outside of like their numbers, like, yeah. So.
Well, I just saw in the video a snapshot of a cyclist, and so I just didn't know if that was maybe they shot on a different day.
Totally, and I mean, as a cyclist, like, that I don't know why anybody would ever, like, subject themselves to that. Yeah, so, but it's not a closed course, because technically, I guess, you can't close the, like, front path.
Okay.
So, yeah.
I was going to say, too, if you're doing all those 5Ks, you'll often run them while that course is open if they're downtown ones.
Yeah, tomorrow's downtown.
Yeah,
so.
Totally. So, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and many of mornings we've gone out, we changed our Sunday morning ride because it's like, obviously, like, Friends are very popular for 5Ks and such, but I mean, as a cyclist, you do not want to be in the middle of that. So, yeah. So the majority of people stay away. Any other questions on the course specifically? Awesome. Okay. So then we move
move on to just some of the things we can talk about, like what for the run specifically do we have as the first timers program and, you know, those great and great endurance. So we have a Tuesday night fun run. It's every Tuesday night, just around the neighborhood. It's super low key. Like, it's just, so just if you're interested, if you're in the West Loop, it's 6 o'clock on every Sunday, or Tuesday. And then we have Grit Endurance Run Training. So again, Grit Endurance is our more coach side. So if there's an aspect of the triathlon that you want a little bit more coaching on and not so much just kind of the community, that's the Grit Endurance side. And so our run training, really, it's Wednesday night track club. So basically that's a place to, yes, work on endurance, but mainly, you know, you work on speed and stuff like that. It's down at the Chicago Avenue track. So it's like Lakeshore Drive and Chicago Avenue. There's a random track there. So it's down there. It's happening right now. Don't skip the clinics for it. So that you can find that on the Grit Endurance website. So, and then again, just highlighting the Do-It-Yourself Triathlon that's coming up on June 23rd. Again, that's going to be down at Ohio Street Beach where we're swimming. And we basically put on a mock triathlon. Again, it's and I guess that's something we talked about last clinic there. So it's in the morning. I think we have it starting at like 6 in order to miss a lot of the people and really have kind of an open course. As we know, marathon training and such has started, so the lakefront is crazy. So, but we started early enough that so you can do all the different disciplines without running into too many people. We have the transition racks there. We'll have a mass group start to kind of simulate the start of a triathlon. So it's really a lot of fun, and it's a good chance to just figure out how it all works, the logistical component of it. So it is $50. However, you do get a $25 Live Grit gift card. And the other $25 is a donation to our Kids Try team. So we do kids triathlon programs in Chicago Public Schools. We have 2 schools now and like 45 kids. So that's what you can find it on our website. And it, I think it's events and services. It says do it yourself triathlon. We limit it to only a certain number of people so that you can have. So that there'll be multiple coaches there to kind of show you like how you set up. I don't know that we will have had the transition clinic yet. We may have, but we'll help you set up your stuff and transition from one to the other, things like that. So.
And do we do the whole distance or is it just like?
It's really up to you. You know, I mean, more often than not, you know, some people that are doing maybe the sprint might do the whole distance. People that are doing the international, we don't really actually maybe recommend doing the whole distance. You can do whatever you want. We'll have 2 of them. So some people start off with the first one. You know, it may only be their first or second time in open water, just getting used to the water, maybe doing half the distance on the bike, and then, you know, half on the run. Really, it's open to you. I think we leave like 3 hours or so it's kind of like whatever you want to do in 3 hours. It's good.
Do you have an idea when the second one will be?
We usually do it late July. Okay. So kind of late July or like right around the beginning of August. Once people have really had time to like get into it and understand it. So yeah. So we'll be figuring that out very soon. Since hardly that it's already. But yeah. Any questions on any of that? Yeah. Runs pretty easy. So gear, again, not a lot. I mean, it's not nearly as extensive as what we talked about for biking or even swimming. But so some of the stuff. So why don't we start? We'll start with clothing and accessories. So if you haven't been to one of the clinics or haven't watched one of the videos yet, what we recommend as far as clothing for the triathlon is, funny enough, triathlon clothing. So there are shorts and tops. There's also one pieces. It's all about preference. So the shorts, again, water wicking, they're tight. They have a little bit of a padding for the bike. Same thing with the top. You know, they tend to be a little bit tighter than like your everyday shirt. Mainly in the aspect that one, swimming, you know, if you were to just swim in your triathlon gear, you don't want it to be super baggy because then it's just gonna, you know, spread out. Also, chafing, you know, anything that moves around too much, like is always an opportunity for chafing. So that's the other reason. One pieces would be these attached to each other. And again, that's a complete personal preference as far as like two piece versus one piece. You know, and I think that the, you know, what people prefer goes up and down, you know. So,
What's the largest size you have?
I mean, we triple X. So we have a variety and we have a couple different styles because we're all different. And so we have some that are, you know, some people like shorter, some people like longer, you know, same thing with tops, like some people have longer torsos. So we have a couple different styles. Like, best thing to do is to try them on. Big thing, you know, they also, what I think is really different between one triathlon short and another is kind of like the leg gripper, you know. I mean, there's nothing worse than like an uncomfortable leg gripper. So you'll see like this one has, it's kind of elasticy versus like the other one we have, which is a Segoya, is more compression. So it's really like just based on like, what do you like? So I'd say try them on and you'll put one on and be like, yes. And put the other one on and be like, no. So yeah, so just try them on and so that's as far as clothing. Has anybody not touched and felt triathlon clothing? We're all good. We also have them all over there, so afterwards. Socks, you know, again, like, most of us know what kind of socks we like, or, if, you know, I mean, they're, you know, if you are barefoot, or you wear those, what they're called, the finger shoes or whatever, then you may not wear socks, but just good thing to have a moisture-wicking pair of socks, you know, a good athletic sock is just something that's important. And some people in the triathlon, you know, we used to have... if you hang around here long enough, you'll hear about Jacob, but he used to change his socks like 3 times in a triathlon, so how that is possible, I don't know. But, so, you know, you can change, some people change their socks, you know, it's again, that's what things like this do-it-yourself triathlon are good for, like, you know, you get some people don't like that you come out of the water and the sock that you put on before the bike gets sand all over and you change it, whatever. But again, if you're going for, like, speed and transitions, then, you know, then you probably won't change your socks, but socks, important. Let's see, accessories, body glide, and we talked about chafing. I mean, the run can, you know, is one of the biggest places where people get chafing, so, and also, if you train, you'll know, you know, where you get chafing, so, but think something like body glide is great to prevent that once you figure out, you know, what that is. It's also good, I don't know if we've talked about it, on the wetsuit, like on the back of the neck. I always put it back there because it takes one wrong time of getting your the Velcro a little too high and it rubs on the back of your neck. So I always, just out of precaution, put it on the back of my neck. Let's see. So nutrition and hydration. This was kind of what we talked about. So there are water stations on the run. So, but it's up to you. You know, some people prefer to have their own hydration with them of what it is that they want. You know, so you can go with the belt or they have the handhelds. You know, you can definitely do that stuff. Do we know what's the hydration on the
Gatorade Endurance?
Okay,
and
so
there are gels as well.
Okay, so Gatorade Endurance is the nutrition on the run.
When I volunteered 2 triathlons ago, it was only the chocolate gel. Do we know the flavor yet?
I don't believe so. We will in advance. Okay. We usually have 2 different flavors in our races.
Okay. Because a lot of people were like, yeah. Oh my god, it's chocolate. No, because it was 150,000
calories. Yes.
Like, I'm not eating chocolate.
Yes.
It's amazing that that matters, isn't it?
Totally.
People wouldn't know that in advance.
So, right?
Yeah.
It's great.
To that point, so gels, you know, so knowing what your nutritional needs are ahead of time, you know, and the good thing, you know, so if you're going to go with what's on course, it's always a good idea, to train with that. Just so you make sure that it sits well with you. And if you aren't going to go with that, then just making sure, you know, don't try campfire some more goo for the first time on race day. Go either way. So, you know, just trying things before race day. Always a good idea.
Okay, yeah. I am lost.
Totally,
what are
yes.
We talking about
perfect.
Today?
Oh, thank you.
Sorry.
Yes. Right. I didn't know. We're bringing
my, it up. I drink water.
Totally.
So.
Perfect. Okay, so water, yes, so there's hydrate, so water, okay. Yes. But another important thing, so the two other important things, one is electrolytes.
Right.
So that's what's going to keep you from getting dehydrated. So, and to get electrolytes, you can get that from something like the Gatorade Endurance, and that's going to have electrolytes in it. You can also do things like these. These are noon tablets. They have zero energy in them. It's all electrolytes, so to help with dehydration. I mean, I personally, like, I'll go through a tube of these probably every other day. You know, I drink them all throughout the day. I'll alternate between normal water and noon. I also dehydrate very quickly.
What is it, though?
So it's basically, so the actual, like...
I mean, do you put it in a...
Water, yeah, oh, totally. Okay. So it's like a tab.
You give it to me, and I'd be like,
arrgh! And you learn really quickly. That sometimes they don't fully dissolve, and I'll be like, whatever, I'll just eat it. And I'm like, nope, that was a bad idea. So you just, you'll dissolve it in water. I'll put it into a water bottle, and then just drink it throughout the day, or... especially like on the bike, I will usually have, and again, every body is different, so don't go off of exactly what, you know, that I do this, but I'll put one bottle of normal water on my bike and then one bottle of this, so, and then alternate between water and an electrolytes drink. So that's what electrolytes, so you have water, you have electrolytes, and then you have energy. And that's where you want to consume some kind of calories to get you through. And it's important of what calories. Now, I'm not going to pretend to be, you know, like a nutritionist that I know exactly like the right formula. But people that make these know it, so they've made them. And so basically, you know, a good rule of thumb is that you want 90 to 100 calories every 45 minutes to an hour. Again, that's just a rule of thumb. Like, everybody is different. I know that on hot days, every 45 minutes, if I go to an hour, I start to bonk. So I've learned that, you know, and to take a goo every 45 minutes. You know, and that's from, and think about the race as a whole, you know, continuum. So if I'm in doing the sprint, I'd take one before the swim, and then 45 minutes later, you know, I'm on the bike. And then, you know, gauging where we are on the run, like whether there needs to be one on the run as well. So that's what, like, chews and stuff like in these goos, these are all about that energy component. If you just go off of water, and sometimes you don't even know it until you try, like, stuff like this. Like, you know, sometimes I'll be on a run and I'll be like, yeah, I feel okay. And you take one of these, and I'm like, whoa, I feel amazing. Like, you sometimes don't know that you've kind of hit a low. The other thing about, you know, especially with like hydration, is once you're dehydrated, it's really difficult, especially in an event, to get rehydrated. So you never want to get to the place, like, if, you know, and I have, like, I have stories of this, of like, you know, going on being in an event and like wiping my face and being covered in, like, you know, salt. Yeah, and it's like, that's not good. So, you know, of really staying ahead of your hydration, and being in August, it's a wild card as to what the weather's going to be. You know, and what I would say is the biggest mistake that we see of first-time kind of triathletes is not drinking on the bike. You can't, if you go the whole bike and you don't reach down for your water bottle, that's going to make for a pretty rough run. So really, like, practicing, I know we talked about this at the bike, but just to reiterate it, really practicing, like, grabbing your water bottle on the bike and learning to be able to drink as you're riding is huge. So that's one thing. The other thing, you know, so I brought these out. So these are salt stick fast chews. So basically, these are, it's a chew that gives you the sodium, potassium, calcium, and magnesium that you need to stay hydrated. So this is also, and like these, again, like I'm a really heavy sweater, like so on a hot day, like stuff, these are a lifesaver as far as kind of keeping me going.
Do they make you salty?
Salty.
Thirsty.
They don't make you, no. I mean, you do, and I'm sure they, I mean, you do want to continue to drink water. You're not going to know. And they actually dissolve pretty nicely, at least I found. You know, and they also have, I mean, I've always, these are easier. They do have like a pill form that you basically just take the pill of it. But yeah.
These taste like candy.
These taste like candy. All right. No, it's candy. Yeah, so they need water, electrolytes, and then some sort of energy. And that, you know, you can even map out, you know, especially once we, you know, you do, say, the do-it-yourself triathlon or start to get into the open water and do bike rides, starting to figure out how long each leg might take you, a range, and then just mapping it out. You know, here's where I'm going to be, here's how many, you know, here's where I'm going to be at 45 minutes. Like, so I know that I want to, and also thinking about nutrition as where is it the easiest to take? Like, it is a lot easier to eat a goo in transition than it is, you know, sometimes on the bike, or especially like shot blocks. I mean, these have 2 servings per container, and a lot of like the chewy things do. And so figuring out how do you split them apart, that's why, and it's personal opinion by everybody, but I mean, goo, once you acquire the taste for the campfire s'more, super easy, you know, like, because you just rip it. But there are so many different kinds of nutrition things out there. You know, and we'll bring in the whatever's on the course so that you can try that. So we'll make sure we get that. And start, again, I mean, if they, you know, if you're going to do what they have on the course, then definitely try it ahead of time.
Are Camelback, like, backpack hydration systems allowed?
Yeah.
They're allowed. The only thing that I'm usually often will suggest against it, mostly because on the bike, you have spots on your bike that can carry water.
Yeah.
So throwing something heavy that you now have to carry that you're going to sweat on into is kind of a little bit more cumbersome. And on the run course is so well supported that if you really ran out of water, I'd be very surprised.
And then you can theoretically have like a 6-pack of bananas in your transition, right? Eat a banana, go swim, come back, eat a banana, go bike.
And so what I would say is, if a banana is what you've trained on, whatever it is. Yeah, exactly. I mean, that's, you know, yeah, you, whatever it is, you know, there's people that, I mean, gummy bears, whatever it is, you know, I mean, you can have that in transition, and that's an easy place to eat. So, you know, and it's all of, I mean, you know, somebody that, like, I know I've referenced this before, but we have the guy here that holds the record for the fastest transition at Chicago, and he'd probably be like, no, you cannot eat a banana in transition. But it's all about, you know, what I like to weigh is what's your comfort level, what is going to make the race the most enjoyable for you. And so, yeah, you know, eating a banana in transition might add 35 or a minute onto your transition time. You know, is that important to you? And that's what it's like, yes.
On the flip side, 1 year we did also have the athlete who had the, I won't say slowest, longest transition. And he fully admits to making a PB, not eating, making a PB&J sandwich in transition. And I gotta say, I saw him several times that day, and he was having a wonderful time.
Or I had a good friend who, you know, I was doing a triathlon with, and I was like, "What are you like? Why did it take you so long?" So we came out of the water at the same time, you know, and I was like 3 minutes or 4 minutes ahead, and she was like, "Oh, well, you know, like, I'm not winning this thing, so I want to look really good in the pictures." So she did her hair, like, and had the mirror, and like, you know what? Like, that's what she wanted to do. So I'm like, go for it. Next time I'm not waiting for you. So it's really kind of like, you know, what is going to make the day the most enjoyable for you? And if, like, yeah, you know, and if you've trained on something that's easier to eat in the transition area, go for it. Yeah. So... So any other questions as far as nutrition and hydration? Again, as far as like it's all personal. So if you have any like personal questions, like I start to feel this, or you start noticing things like halfway through my bike, like I just feel like I have zero energy, reach out to us and we can kind of work with you individually. So, yeah.
Bathrooms on the course.
Oh, yes.
We're gonna talk about that.
We can absolutely talk about it. So I'm gonna, there are bathrooms in the transition. There are at the end of the bike course.
Correct.
Yep, up at Hollywood. And then what about on the run?
Yep, every aid station.
Every aid station. So.
About every mile of the run course.
Oh,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Nice.
So there are lots of options.
Good.
Yeah. Any other questions on that?
And, I mean, there'll be, like, multiple ones. You don't have to, like, stand in line to use the one bathroom.
No guarantees on the aid stations. Usually we drop one per aid station.
Okay.
But between transition and the swim start, the swim exit, there's tons of porta potties everywhere.
Okay, okay. I have to go before I run.
Yep.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter.
Absolutely.
Anytime.
Yeah. So shoes. So I'm briefly getting biggest recommendation for shoes is to go someplace that specializes in fitting running shoes and get a pair of well-fit running shoes. You know, that's not our specialty, so I'm not really gonna like go deep into it. Go to some place that, you know, whether it's wherever nearby you, whatever it is, that will fit you for running shoes, because there are so many different considerations within running shoes and mechanics, and it's a great way to prevent injury and to and comfort. So that's what I'd say on shoes. So, pretty sure. But, yeah.
Laces.
Yeah. There's the speed. Yeah, I didn't bring them out. Rashawn's gonna get them. Yeah, so you have the tie up, like normal shoes. And then there's speed laces, which basically you slide your foot in and then pull a cord, and it's a quick way to not have to tie your shoes. Yeah.
They look like this.
Yeah.
So, well, my shoes right now.
Look how well they work.
As I accidentally pull it out.
Ah, okay. I'm going to play a light.
So,
yeah.
They're normally, if I'm racing, they'll be set like this.
Mm-hmm.
And then I will either literally just pull them on because they're elastic.
Yeah.
And then if I need to, I can adjust how tight I want.
Yeah.
And
what's up?
And that's the cord.
Totally.
I can't
see
that at all. Can you
show me?
Second.
Yeah,
so
then, a little tight now.
I got
A6. So, because they're elastic, I can literally grab
new
them
ones.
And just pull them right out.
Blue ones. Blue A6.
I like
it.
Oh,
nice. What?
I went to 3T.
Oh, okay. I was like, I've never heard of that story.
I had like a half hour.
Totally.
Free,
right? Yeah.
Work in here, so like, I mean,
yeah.
Perfect.
Trying to get there forever.
Nice.
Right.
Yeah. Exactly.
Did you run on the treadmill? And they?
I ran outside and just because they had like some running thing going on there. So
packet
so.
Pickup.
I don't know.
Oh.
Well, it was something like. Oh yeah, maybe. They
were you in the South Loop?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what it was. I was there too. But
yeah,
to pick up a pack.
Is that the one on the Roosevelt connection?
Yep.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
And to the point, that's what you're looking for. Somebody that's going to watch you run,
mm-hmm.
watch how you're, what your mechanics, how you hit the ground, and then help you choose a shoe that's right for that. So that's what you want.
Sweet.
All right. Any questions on gear? Run gear? Any other gear?
So when they say electronics, they're more specifically talking about like phones and headphones,
uh-huh.
watches, and watches are okay.
Okay.
It's basically no communication or like things that will block or change your safety, right? So no headphones.
We need all of your senses all day.
What?
There should
boring.
Be no Instagram stories during the
Mine was a non-run question. It was about open water goggles.
Yeah.
They're different than regular goggles. goggles?
So, I mean, it depends on what you're talking about as far as regular goggles go. So, open water goggles, the big difference between, I'd say, you know, what you want in an open water goggle is one that it's got a good suction. So you want to avoid like the little, you know, sit in the eye socket, like racer goggles. So like these, you know, you can tell that there's a lot, a good suction. The other thing that you want to look about in an open water goggle is that they'll wrap around the side a little bit, and not huge. I mean, we're not looking for like all the way around, but just enough that you get some peripheral vision. Because you're out there and you have to sight and things like that. The other thing would be most people like some kind of tinting and then some, you know, that there's polarized goggles, things like that. Biggest things though is because you think about it, you're in the open water, like had we swam on Saturday with 7 foot swells, you know, like water's hitting you in the face, you don't want them to just pop off. You know, so you want a solid, like, good suction, and then kind of the how much can you see in them. So what I would say is, you know, a lot of, you know, like, Blue 70, for example, is an open water company, so the 90% of their goggles are great for open water. We also sell, like, tier goggles, which, you know, they do a lot of pool stuff, and probably our most popular goggle is not an open water specific goggle, but has all of the characteristics. So it's not like you have to go and like look for something that directly says open water goggle. Just don't go with those little like sit in the socket kind of goggles.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Okay. Yep.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And there's all different kinds. I mean, they've got like the face masks and things like that, but yeah, but all of our goggles here would be good for open water. Yeah, any other, yeah.
Face belts, are they worth it?
Yes.
They're
yes,
not that
expensive. Yeah,
and
so it's the race belt. If this is a race belt, I mean, I think these $12 or something, $14. Basically, it's a belt that if you haven't seen one. So in triathlons, different numbers are required at different times. So in the swim, you have your cap and your timing chip, you'll have your markings on your body, but most likely in a wetsuit, so nobody's going to see that. On the bike, you have numbers for your bike, and you have numbers for your helmet, and again, your body markings. For the run, it's the only time that you need that typical like 5K, you know, bib number.
Mm-hmm.
So, just thinking about it, you're coming into transition, you don't want to sit there pinning it on. Okay, and what you also don't want is to ride with it pinned on, because then it's just going to flap the whole time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's where the race belt comes in. And they're good for 5Ks too, you know, I mean.
I've never done a race. Since I bought that myself a race belt, I've never done a race, whether it's run, bike, but run or triathlon, where I haven't used it, because I don't want to put pins in my shirts and ruin them anymore.
Totally. And if you're like me, you get frustrated after two, so you're like, that's all I'm putting on, and you really regret it halfway through the run. So basically it's got these little toggles, and you know, there's different little strings on this one, because some, you know, there's no one bib. So basically you just put the bib on here, you put the toggle on, and then you just put the race belt on. So then you have this, I always put it in my shoes so I can't forget it. I just grab it, put it on, and then out you go. So. Again, it's one of those, it's funny, we're always at the expo and it's like, I mean, we probably go through hundreds and hundreds of these, because it is like one of those kind of not very expensive thing that will just make your life so much easier, so.
Could you change t-shirts? Like, you come back from bicycling, take that t-shirt off and put the t-shirt that you already carefully pinned the bib to.
That it would be the other solution, there's no rule on, you can switch, you know, again, it's more of like a hassle thing, like, but you can totally do that and have it pre-pinned on.
The only other thing would be like kind of the decency rules, don't get naked in transition.
That's a rule?
That we commonly have to tell people.
Got it.
But you can have a sports bra on, like that doesn't count as nude. Yeah.
Define naked.
It's usually the men that we've got to talk to.
Good God.
Anyways. Any other gear questions?
Actually, for hydration and nutrition.
really. And what I would say, again, this is one of those things that it's worth practicing sometimes. Like, we always say, like, don't do something new the day before, you know, or the evening before. You know, it's worth maybe, you know, not eating the greasy cheeseburger, unless that is really just what you have done, like, the whole time. But, you know, we would say, like, don't all of a sudden eat, like, a, you know, a bowl full of pasta if you've been gluten-free for, you know, like, 6 months. Like, stick with what you do. The other thing is, you know, there's some things that are more difficult to digest. And that's even, like, when you talk about before, like, all of this nutrition and stuff and all the stuff over there is easily and quickly digested. So things like high fiber thing are difficult on the gut to digest. I mean, they're healthy for the gut, but they're also difficult. So staying away from that stuff, maybe, or not going overboard. As far as kind of like the morning of, again, like, stick with what you know. And knowing that at the triathlon, so if you're doing the international distance, like, you are going both, if you're doing both distances, you're going to get there, you know, probably a couple hours before you actually get in the water. So you're probably going to eat something at home and then need to do something right before the event. And that's when something like this comes in, like doing a goo or something like that. Something that's going to hit the bloodstream quickly, so when you hit the water, you're ready to go.
And so on that note, Gillian's exactly right. Don't change what you're doing. A couple notes on that. She mentioned avoiding fiber and high fat stuff. It's harder for your body to digest. It'll just sit really heavy in you. Carbo loading is not really a thing. I know in high school we were probably all taught it. It doesn't really do anything for you, so don't try and, again, don't change anything. And then in terms of, like, breakfast, if you're not changing anything, I eat Fruit Loops, like, way more than a man my age should. And race this weekend, I brought a bowl of Fruit Loops. That was my breakfast.
I was like, what are you eating? Like, one, Fruit Loops, and two.
out of a Tupperware before a race. But nice. That's what I practice with. Yeah. That's what works for me, so that's what I did. Mm-hmm. So whatever's comfortable, whatever you do, just make sure you eat something.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So if you are not eating something in the mornings now, start practicing it.
So I was looking at the sheet behind you at the Triathlon Basics.
Yes.
Triathlon issued swim cap.
Yeah.
Does it stay on my head?
I believe it does. Okay. Yeah, I'm not sure. So have you ever had that
complaint?
And
my pants fall off all the time, so.
The swim cap should be fine. The big thing with, because I used to shave my head for swimming, the big things are don't shine your head, right? So make sure that it's kind of dry. And then if you've never worn a swim cap, start practicing, because you don't want a headache the day of the race, because now you're putting something compressive on.
Okay.
I also don't want a sandbar.
Yes.
Yeah, I was thinking about that too.
I mean, on that run in general, especially if we're lucky enough to have a sunny day, I mean, hats are a great thing, or vice or something, because that sun does kind of beat down. So hats are good in general. I mean, so sunglasses, you know, they make sports-specific sunglasses, and not that you, I mean, it's not, I have certainly ran in my aviators before, but they are just not nearly as, like, the ventilation issue, and the other thing is, you know, having a sunglass that you can wear for the bike and the run, on the bike, the way that these sunglasses, when you're not looking straight ahead, you're like this and then looking up, so they're designed in a way to not cut off your viewpoint. A lot of them, like these, you can see have like a hole up here. That's gonna keep them from fogging up. So that's the, you know, when she starts sweating and things like that. They wrap around the side again, you know, to give you that peripheral vision. So I mean, I would say like a pair of like sports-specific sunglasses, what they've designed in them, are nice to have.
One thing to note on that, is anyone here doing the Olympic? If you're doing the Olympic, the bike course will take you from Lakeshore Drive down to Laurel Back. So when you go onto that lower whacker, if you are not prepared, you go from really bright to, oh my goodness, where did everything go? And you can see it just takes a moment for your light or your eyes to adjust. So if you're doing the Olympic, I wear photo check lenses, basically lenses that will change darkness depending on how much light there is. Those are really wonderful for that. Or just be cognizant of,
it's coming.
I may either need to change sunglasses or figure out something that is a little lighter lens. Taking your sunglasses off on the bike could work, but I wouldn't recommend it for a couple reasons. One, when you get on lower whacker, it is a little dusty, so there is stuff that is flying. And two, when you're on your bike, you're moving fast. So air is gonna be hitting you, you don't necessarily wanna dry those eyeballs out.
Swimming? Yes, no?
Totally up to you.
Yeah.
They really help a lot of people with if you get nauseated in the swim or have trouble with getting ears in your water in your ears.
Trouble with the first one.
Why do you get nauseated when you swim?
Because you get equilibrium.
Yeah. So water's hitting your eardrum, and your eardrum is partially how you control your balance. So people can oftentimes feel off balance or nauseated because
of water. Is that different than if they were swimming somewhere else?
Pool and open water is often different in that case because you do have either waves or a current. But a lot of people, like, you would often know beforehand if you would get nauseated in that water. If you ever get seasick, car sick, that's a similar kind of thing.
See, I get motion sick pretty easily, but I've never had a problem
in water before.
I mean, you're familiar with the ocean.
So everyone's kind of different, you know, but earplugs will help with that.
Yeah, and that's, sorry, I was like, oh no. If you get sick, I do, so.
And I had swim in open water for a long time, and then all of a sudden, like a year ago, I started swimming, and I just would feel awful after, and earplugs solved that problem. It was completely, and it was all about, the water.
And can you use the little ones that you, like?
The waxy ones? Yeah.
Well, they're not waxy, they're like.
They're like a foam that you squeeze and push in. Yeah, that'll work. It's really just a personal preference. Like, those don't fit in my ear, so I have to use the waxy kind if I'm using them. It doesn't fit in your ear, great.
I use them all the time. I got three kids.
Yeah, totally. It's always that it's just like trying to, don't do anything new on race day is always just try it and figure it out. Yeah, so. Yeah. Sweet. All right. So training, so as far as the run goes, a lot of different things to take into consideration. So obviously, we sent out a kind of a pretty basic training plan that incorporates run. So you can have, so the different kinds of runs are going to be either your long runs or your, you know, what some people would term like tempo runs, which so your long runs are going to be at a lesser pace, but maybe longer in distance, versus your tempo runs are going to be your shorter in distance, higher or faster pace. Both serve, purposes. One, long runs are for endurance. Tempo runs are for speed. When you have a good combination of them both, you build endurance and speed. So you'll see those on the, that's what, like when we talk about track club, that would fit underneath tempo runs. That's all about building speed, and endurance, but primarily speed. Learning kind of your pacing, like after we go through the summer and you've been training, you should kind of understand like, this is my realistic kind of pace on the run. And remembering that the run comes post swimming and biking. So it's not like you're just going out for a 5K. You're going out for a 5K after you just swam and biked. And so having that, and the reason why pacing is good, I actually find it's
in my opinion, it's more on the aspect that you come out of that transition area, and sometimes like you're like, this is amazing, like in that adrenaline as goes, all of a sudden you're doing like 2 minutes faster than, you know, what you've kind of determined your pace is, and about a mile into it, you're like, yep, I'm done. You know, and so that's what it is. It's like you're controlling that kind of adrenaline coming out onto the run. You know, we always talk about, you know, it's like if you get halfway into your run and you're like, I feel amazing, all right, pick it up. But what, you know, you don't necessarily want the slow kind of decline through the run. So, you know, knowing what your pacing is, and even if that comes down to kind of like the feel, what does it feel like? Bricks, we've talked about this a few times, important, and those are in those training plans. I don't think they really start until 2 or 3 weeks in. You know, we want you to build kind of that base before you jump into bricks. But bricks are, specifically in triathlon, I mean, you can do a brick of like a swim to a bike, but most importantly, it's the bike to the run. And the idea is to get your legs comfortable with getting off the bike and going for a run, because it is a different feeling. So, highly recommend not skipping those sections of the training plan. Again, a brick is usually a longer bike with a shorter run. So the run does not have to be, you're not gonna go out and do the 5K. You know, you're gonna do your long ride and then you're gonna tack on 5 to 10 minutes of a run at the end of it. So it's more about getting those legs moving and starting to get the body where it can transition from the bike to the run. As far as form goes, I am going to turn that over because you do not want to run like me. So, Rashawn, who has much better form, is going to talk a little bit about running form.
So, a lot of, for biking and swimming, you usually have to be taught, you have to kind of figure out, you never really learn how to run, you just kind of, as a kid, you go run. So, for most of the things when we talk about form for running, we're not going to really change that too much. When you're looking at shoes should guide and support you the way you run. So it shouldn't necessarily change the way you run. A lot of people will have probably have heard about heel striking, forefoot, midfoot striking, or forefoot striking.
Toe running.
Let's just go ahead and assume that you can ignore all of that, and whatever you do is okay. There's a common misconception out there that heel striking or landing on your heel first and then rolling through your foot is bad. And that's not really the case. The better way to explain it is if I were to land out in front of me, whether it's on my heel or my forefoot, toes, whatever, out in front of me, because it's in front of me, my knee is kind of straight, I'm going to get, you can kind of see the rest of my body, a lot more shock go through my body. And then I have to roll through, so I just put more pressure on my knee. That's a common way to get knee issues. So the key is not necessarily how you land on the ground, but where you land on the ground. So as you're running, you should always land kind of right underneath you. So whether you heel strike or toe strike or midfoot strike, you should be running so that, sorry, not much distance here, but so that your feet land right underneath you, okay? So that's in terms of legs. If someone tells you, oh, you're heel striking, that's wrong, don't listen to them. Just make sure that you're not getting that huge impact as you're running. The rest of the body, it's pretty straightforward. You wanna kind of stand up straight, keep your chest out nice and open, looking forward. You're gonna be going where you're looking, so keep that head nice and high. Tendency is to let it just kind of fall and, you know, hate it. So stand up straight, make sure you can get that breath. And then what do you do with the rest of your body, right? So the common thing would be to cross over your body, but what you really wanna do is keep your arms moving forward and back, okay? These are gonna allow your arms moving. If you start moving them faster, you'll actually move faster. Your arms and legs will work together. So your arms will move with your legs. They're gonna go forward and back, not side to side. You never wanna cross over. And the reason for that is, as I'm moving forward and back, you can see it's a forward motion. My chest is going forward and back and not crossing over. As my legs would be doing the same thing, forward and back, not rotational. As soon as I get this, I'm now rotating all my upper body against what my legs are doing. And so especially for women, you're going to have a lot more chest and shoulder pain when that happens. You're going to feel it a lot more after the run. So make sure your arms are moving forward and back. They're not hunched up. I don't have my shoulders all the way up here, nice and loose. So I often remind our runners, shake your arms out, keep those hands nice and loose. You shouldn't be gripping really hard. And the last kind of tip on form is just keep your hands below your elbows and nice and loose. Everything should feel kind of smooth. Any questions on form? Things like that? As the more you run, the more you'll start to feel how it's working and how you run well, keeping in mind the things that we just talked about. But as you run more, if you start to feel pain in certain places, or there's certain times like, oh, I do this and this hurts, or I do this and I go slower or faster, keep those in mind. You know, if you're working with a coach or working with us, you can come talk to us. We'll figure that out and help you along that way.
And I think one thing we maybe didn't hit upon, but also, you know, and the run-walk method is a great method as well. So just knowing that you know, like, if you want to try the run-walk, which would be doing, you know, some interval of run followed by a walk, but that is totally perfect. And there is actually a whole school of thought around that it's actually, I don't know what the right word is, but.
Obviously, this is anecdotal, but my fastest marathon was a run walk.
Yeah.
I did 10 minutes run, 1 minute walk, and because of that walk period of just a minute, that would allow me to recover and then run faster than I would have just if I tried to run the whole time. And you're allowing your body to recuperate mm-hmm. before you go again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and with that, if you are going to try, you know, and work on the run walk method, a good thing to remember is, you know, you have the run. But the walk is not necessarily like a, you know, like a stroll through the park. Like, it's an active walk, you know, and you basically, and I think Rosano always shows it best, how you go from like one to the next, but it's a...
So you're running and then you continue walking. The form is going to be the same, and then I'm running, right? My upper body is staying the same, I'm looking forward, my arms are still moving, it's just my legs are either taking a quick walking pace, or running. And the reason for that is, if you're running and you come to a stop, so you're running and you come to a stop, you can see there's a lot of body movement, everything drops, and there's, for lack of a better word, kind of hurts. And then from the opposite, you go, I've got to pick everything up and then kind of jump to start running. Versus, if I'm that active walk, I can run and transition to walk in one step without whole lot of movement, a whole lot of stuff. So an active walk is what you want to be doing, not just kind of ball walking, as I like.
And a quick glance over your shoulder and not just dead stop. So
yeah.
The next.
And actually, that's a really good point. This is kind of a running. Right, there's a running etiquette kind of thing. If you've ever done bike signals, like I'm turning right, I'm stopping, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Same with running. If you put your hand up, that means you're changing pace. So if I'm running and I put my hand up, that means I'm most likely going to start walking. If I'm walking and I put my hand up, I'm most likely going to start running. So if you see people around you doing that, that's what they're communicating.
Uh-huh.
To.
Any questions on training in general for the triathlon or the run portion of it?
As long as they're also an athlete.
Right.
Yeah.
A registered athlete. But they don't have to, you don't have to like worry about being
like drafting them.
Yeah, like three people lengths behind.
Drafting is a thing in running, and you don't have to worry about it. You can draft all you want. Line up behind the big person and just sit there if you want.
It's just a matter of being considerate of your environment. If you're walking three or running three abreast, mm-hmm. three friends hanging out, and you're blocking somebody from behind you, there could be something to that.
Yeah, that's true.
Are there any running penalties?
What are the running penalties?
Typically littering,
trash training,
and
headphones.
Headphones
and litter.
And shoving, and elbows.
Yeah, that's sportsmanlike conduct for sure.
contact sport around him?
Actually, I have a littered question, because most of the time you hydrate with a cup and you chuck it and keep going. Is that littering?
If you're within bounds of an aid station and there's staff there, there's garbage cans, then you're fine.
Okay.
If you're out in the middle of nowhere and you just discard something out into the grass, then that's a little bit more substantial.
Okay.
And in terms of the aid stations, there will be the aid stations and you will see a series of trash cans right after it. And you will know, like, that's the last trash can. I've got to there to throw it out.
Okay.
There'll be people cleaning up as you go, but it'll be very evident, like, this is a place I can put my stuff. Mm-hmm.
And that applies on the bike course as well. Mm-hmm. So, otherwise, you're just littering the city.
Right.
Yeah. We're not going to clean up all of Lake Shore Drive.
Yeah.
Not typically.
All right. Yeah, so that is basically what we had for the run. So I think the next up, which I gotta say tends to be one of the more popular ones, is transition. So that's basically gonna be, we'll usually do it outside and kind of a more kind of interactive, not don't bring your stuff or anything, but just actually show it and stuff outside. So that will be in a couple of weeks. But and you, I haven't read the emails, or just as a reminder, this Saturday, weather permitting, but it looks good, I think, we'll do our first open water swim. So we will be down there from 7 to 9-ish. So come on down and get in the lake. It is getting warmer, so you're good, you're fine now. We're doing our Sunday morning ride. So if you haven't gotten out on your bike and haven't, so we basically ride the runner course. Come on, 8 a.m. here every Sunday. But any final questions? Anything?
Have you guys been in the lake yet? Anybody? Yeah?
Just me?
What's the temperature? What was the temperature?
It was like 55 when I first got out.
Do you think it's at or a little bit above 60?
No wetsuit time.
Which is
Rashad is different.
Fruit Loops and no wetsuit. Well, awesome. Well, thanks for coming. Yeah, and
thank you very much.
And we'll wrap this all up into an email. So if you have any other questions, please reach out to us.